This week on Vaticano. Pope Francis returns from the hospital 11 days after a surgery.
Buongiorno.
And in his first week back, he makes some sudden decisions regarding the traditional Latin Mass. Learn with us about the path to sainthood of one of the founders of the European Union. And discover the world's most watched online adoration chapel, a chapel first envisioned by St. Maximilian Maria Kolbe himself. For this and more, Vaticano starts now. Starting on July the 4th, Pope Francis was at the Agostino Gemelli University Polyclinic Hospital in Rome for colon surgery. During his convalescence, he visited young patients at the pediatric oncology ward of the hospital. He blessed children undergoing treatment, and medical workers gave him an enthusiastic welcome. After 11 days in the hospital, Pope Francis returned to the Vatican on July the 14th. On his way home, he stopped to pray at the Basilica of St. Mary Major, where according to the Vatican Press Office, he expressed his gratitude for the success of his surgery and offered a prayer for all the sick, especially those he had met during his stay in the hospital. The day after his return, the Holy Father wrote a letter to thank the hospital's administration and medical staff for their fraternal reception and warm care that made him feel at home. And on Sunday, July the 18th, at his weekly Angelus, Pope Francis invited the faithful not only to rest physically this summer.
Perché non basta staccare la spina, occorre riposare davvero.
It is not enough to unplug ourselves. We need to truly rest. And how do we do this? To do so, we must return to the heart of things. To stop, to remain in silence, to pray so as not to go from the frenzy of work to the frenzy of times of relaxation. Let us be aware, brothers and sisters, of efficiency. Let us put a halt to the frantic running around dictated by our agendas. Let us learn how to take a break, to turn off the mobile phone, to contemplate nature, to regenerate ourselves in dialogue with God.
A contemplare la natura, a rigenerarci nel dialogo con Dio.
After the Angelus, the Holy Father prayed for those suffering from unrest in South Africa and for the victims of the floods in Germany. And he expressed his closeness to the dear Cuban people after the largest protests in decades in the communist country.
I pray that the Lord might help the nation construct a society that is more and more just and fraternal through peace, dialogue, and solidarity. I urge all Cubans to entrust themselves to the maternal protection of the Virgin Mary of Charity of Cobre. She will accompany them on this journey.
On July the 16th, Pope Francis issued restrictions on the celebration of the Holy Mass in the extraordinary form of the Roman Rite, also known as the traditional Latin Mass. In a letter to bishops, Pope Francis wrote, "In defense of the unity of the body of Christ, I'm constrained to revoke the faculty granted by my predecessors." But the Pope is allowing for individual bishops to authorize the use of the traditional Latin Mass in their respective dioceses. The Franciscan Order of Friars Minor elected a new minister general on July the 13th. 58-year-old Italian priest Father Massimo Fusarelli will lead the order for the next 6 years. He's the 121st successor of St. Francis of Assisi, succeeding U.S. Franciscan Father Michael Perry. The Franciscan Order was holding their general chapter in Rome, where they reflected on the theme, Renewing Our Vision, embracing our future. In a message to the Franciscan Friars Minor, Pope Francis said, "As much of the order faces the challenges of declining numbers and aging, do not let anxiety and fear prevent you from opening your hearts and minds to the renewal and revitalization that the Spirit of God is stirring in you and among you." More than 1,500 years have passed since the birth of one of the patron saints of Europe, Saint Benedict of Norcia. Born precisely in Norcia, a small town in central Italy, Saint Benedict is one of the protagonists of the birth of European culture, so much so that Saint Gregory defined him as a bright star in a dark century. Many miracles have been attributed to the figure of Saint Benedict, but the most important one is certainly the writing of the rule, marked by the famous Latin phrase, ora et labora, pray and work. The rule of Saint Benedict is a manual of prayer for monastic life, composed in the year 540 in Monte Cassino, Italy, where he founded the first abbey of what we know today as the Benedictine Order. It all began when Saint Benedict was only 17 years old and he set out for the Valley of Subiaco, about 43 miles east of Rome. Living as a hermit until Easter of the year 500, announcing the Word of God and welcoming more and more disciples. Benedict's spirituality is still witnessed to today at the sanctuary of the Sacro Speco, located near Subiaco. It's a sanctuary that rises in one of the most significant places in the life of Saint Benedict. Set into the rocky wall of Mount Taleo, there's a cave where, at the beginning of the 6th century, the very young saint followed the example of the anchorite fathers, living as a hermit. During the period of solitude spent in this place, Saint Benedict matured a charisma and spirituality that in a few years led him to found the first monastic communities. As early as the 6th century, the cave of Saint Benedict became a place of worship, but only from the second half of the 11th century did the structure begin to take the form we admire today. Saint Benedict died in 547 in Monte Cassino. In October of 1964, Pope Saint Paul VI proclaimed him patron saint of Europe. In doing so, said Benedict XVI in 2008, Paul VI intended to recognize the marvelous work the saint achieved with his rule for the formation of the civilization and culture of Europe. In a few moments, we'll be back with more on Vaticano. The European Union was not always united. It took six men with a shared desire to reconcile in the wake of two world wars. These men are known as the founding fathers of Europe. one of whom Pope Francis declared venerable in June of 2021.
Diplomatic relations is obviously...
Alexandra Valkenburg, the ambassador of the European Union to the Holy See, knows his legacy well.
Robert Schuman is considered one of the founding fathers of the European Union. The declaration he made on the 9th of May 1950, he is a bit, the basis of the European Union.
L'Europe n'a pas été faite, nous avons eu la guerre.
And his vision was to, after his experiences with both world wars, is we have to work together, and by creating the coal and steel community, by making sure that that we work together in the European Union, he hoped to prevent future wars. So it was really a peace project, his vision. And it's been the basis of what the European Union is today.
Robert Schuman was born in Luxembourg in 1886, but had family roots in Lorraine, a territory lost by France to Germany in the Franco-Prussian War. After Lorraine returned to France, Schuman served as a member of France's parliament in the Christian Democrat political party.
With that background, he really felt, how do I prevent future wars is by bringing us together, by working together, by creating this this community. Steel and coal were obviously essential elements for the arms industry. So working together in that was his vision of creating, making sure that these countries would work together in the future.
Robert Schuman understood his Catholic mission as a politician, dedicated to serving the common good, promoting peace and reconciliation. It was upon these Christian values that the European Union was built, and his firm belief in them led him to become the first president of the European Parliament.
Proclamo quindi presidente delle comunità europee l'onorevole Roberto Schuman e lo invito ad assumere la presidenza.
The basis of freedom of religion and belief is really anchored in the European Union treaty. And I think that is important that we all stand for that inside Europe and outside Europe. So that would be my answer. Of course, there is a separation of state and church, but within the treaties we have anchored that freedom of religion or belief.
The EU and the Holy See share common interests and continue to work together after 50 years of diplomatic relations. In a letter to Europe on October the 22nd of 2020, the Holy Father wrote, "I dream then of a Europe that is a friend to each and all. I dream of a Europe that is a family and a community. I dream of a Europe that is inclusive and generous. I dream of a Europe marked by a healthy secularism where God and Caesar remain distinct but not opposed." On June the 26th, the President of the European Parliament, David Sassoli, met with Pope Francis. They talked about this solidarity and the rights of people being the measure of all things. To highlight the deep historic links between the EU and the Holy See, as well as the unity of Europe, Ambassador Valkenburg organized a walking route to 25 churches in Rome, together with European ambassadors to the Holy See.
So it was really a collaborative effort of the EU delegation and the 27 member states, and because we organized it in a way that we every Sunday throughout 8 Sundays we did part of the walkway, often starting with a Holy Mass and then visiting another church with, for instance, some music or a guided tour. So everybody was involved and could could show a bit what their link is with that church, or what the diplomatic relations with the Holy See mean for them.
The European Union has come a long way and continues to look towards Robert Schumann's heroic virtues to guide it towards a better future. Europe will not be made all at once or according to a single plan. It will be built through concrete achievements, which first create a de facto solidarity. We'll be back after a short break with more on Vaticano. The City of the Immaculate Mother of God, in Polish, Neopokalanów. This is how St. Maximilian Maria Kolbe called this monastery he founded in 1927, 30 miles from Poland's capital city of Warsaw. Before the Second World War, it was the largest Catholic monastery in the world, housing around 760 men.
St. Maximilian never gave up.
The current guardian of Neopokalanów, Father Mariusz Szwowik, says that St. Maximilian envisioned a basilica, a minor seminary, a typography, a radio station, and even a friar-manned fire brigade here.
St. Maximilian Kolbe had great devotion to Our Lady, and he wanted to win the world to Christ, to Our Lady.
One of St. Maximilian's weapons to win souls was the monthly magazine called The Knights of the Immaculate. It was produced here by the friars in a huge print run, 750,000 copies a month.
Today, we continue the work of St. Maximilian Kolbe through prayer, through monastic religious life.
Father Mariusz says that in 2018, the shrine was updated with this perpetual adoration chapel.
Saint Maximilian dreamed to have this chapel, and in this chapel is permanently adoration 24 hours a day.
In the last 3 years, the chapel has become the site of the biggest online adoration prayer in the world, transmitted by EWTN Poland and counting an average of 300 people praying online at any given time.
Hello, my name is Anna Maria. I work here in the archives, and I'd like to tell you about the chapel. It's called the Star of the Immaculate.
The altar was made by the Polish artist Mariusz Drapikowski, who, together with his art studio and the Society Comunità Regina della Pace, have a vision to establish 12 adoration chapels in different countries to pray for peace and reconciliation among people.
In 2018, I believe, they asked if they could start here in Neopokalanów, and the father, the parish priest of the basilica, agreed and got permission from his superiors of the Franciscans here, and they started to build on the side of the sacristy. They cleared it out, And the parish priest, Father Andrew, he asked me, while I work in the archives, do you have any old photographs of how it is built? Because we're looking to see how it was, some history of the church. And I said, yes, I'll send it to you and a little bit of the history. And in that history, with the photos that I sent of the building of the church, there was that little fragment of what St. Maximilian had written in 1934 about how he envisioned the church, which they had planned before the war.
This letter was written by St. Maximilian while he was on a mission trip in Japan. In it, he tells the father guardian of that time about the plans for the new basilica.
On the main altar, I envision a beautiful statue of the Immaculata with arms outstretched, functioning as a backdrop to the monstrance for perpetual exposition of the Blessed Sacrament.
The letter was little known, and the artist of the altar, Drapikowski, didn't know anything about the vision of St. Maximilian.
When he found out about this letter, he already had planned, and he was so very much moved that his idea matched so well with the idea of St. Maximilian. So that also helped in, confirming that this is the place to have the chapel.
Sister Anna Maria says there are a lot of people coming to pray here, and many of them claim to receive spiritual and physical healings.
One man, I don't remember his name, but he also said that he had a very severe back problem, and the doctor said he had to go for a surgery. And he often came here to pray in the chapel. And one day when he was praying the rosary, he felt a sharp, extreme warmth going down his spine. And afterwards, the pain, he didn't feel the pain. And he went to the doctors, and they examined him again and said, you don't have the hernia anymore.
On February the 5th, 2019, the Apostolic Penitentiary bestowed the grace of a plenary indulgence to those who visit the shrine in the next 7 years. The sick, the elderly, and those who, for other important reasons, for example, COVID-19 restrictions, cannot visit the shrine, can obtain the indulgence through online adoration and fulfilling the requirements established by the Church.